Welcome to our fifth week of Politics of Code. The topic of today's surveillance and control is probably at the heart of what most people associate with if digital technology is political. We have seen in the first 2 weeks in how far we can even think that all technology is to some extent political. The discussion about techno-determinism or social constructivism is an interpretation of this political quality of all technology. With the digital technology, however, the public awareness over the last 15 or so years of the pervasiveness of the intrusion into people's lives that technology has, not so much in their bodily lives, so to say, but in their intellectual, in their emotional lives, by means of directly interfering in their conversations, listening into their very private behaviors, what we read, what we do online, what we share with friends. Reconstructing what we are interested in, and so on, that is a specific part of contemporary digital technology. What we want to show today or to discuss today is that we should take back a step and look at technology again from a very broad perspective, as part of people's culture, as part of people's society, and realize maybe that technology as such is always a means of exerting power, of establishing hierarchies, of controlling, keeping people in their place. In the readings, you have a chapter of the book Discipline and Punish by Michel Foucault. So this book represents the late phase of Foucault's oeuvre. I will introduce Foucault as a person in a minute. The original title, as you see here, is different. It says Survey et punir. So Foucault, however, himself, always admitting that he wouldn't speak much English and so on, but probably being aware of enough English to realize that the word surveillance, which of course is directly linked to the French as are like two-thirds of the English vocabulary, has a different connotation in English. So surveillance in English, according to Foucault, in his discussion with the translators of his books in the 1970s, in English has always a technical meaning. It is always some means of surveillance. That could also be some procedure or some political means, but it is too technical. It is not so much what the French would associate, according to Foucault, with the word survey. And he thinks that the meaning of to discipline is much closer to what he intended to put in the title. So this is why the English translation has the title Discipline and Punish, The Birth of the Prison. So Foucault elaborates on that a bit. For example, Jeremy Bentham, an English engineer and father of the Panopticon prison, as we will discuss in a bit. He uses the word to inspect, and Foucault says, well, my idea of survey is very close to what Bentham used as to inspect. Also, he says, what people say as supervise, like for example in schools or in offices. So if you have a supervisor or in a building, the building supervisor, that is what he thinks with this first word of his title. And the major question that is raised in this book comes from Foucault's commitment to understanding everything that we look at in a historical perspective. So during his studies, as we shall discuss, he comes to the conviction that we always learn by looking at history. Today we would probably say also to look at different cultures in the world, how they do things, and then see how our current state of things is contingent and by no means necessary. And in particular, in that book, he asks the question, to what extent is it actually kind of necessary or logic to put people who are thought of being criminal, who are convicted, into a prison cell? And this is the starting point on which he leaves. I'll show you a few seconds of an interview that Foucault gave to the Dutch television, or it's actually a conversation with the American philosopher Noam Chomsky in 1971. It just shows you the way in which Foucault speaks and how he looks, and then I will introduce a bit on his biography.
What do you think about this?
Well, if you permit, I will answer in French, because my English is so bad that I would be ashamed to answer in English. Là, il est vrai que je me méfie un peu de cette notion de nature humaine. Mais je m'en méfie pour la raison suivante. Je crois que parmi les concepts, parmi les notions dont une science peut se servir, il y a évidemment des notions qui sont d'un niveau,
This conversation
qui, sont,
is available
qui ont une élaboration
et une fonction différente.
Par exemple,
bon,
prenons le cas
de
la biologie, à l'intérieur, dans le domaine
so much,
de la biologie, vous avez des concepts qui sont
plus ou moins
comme
les concepts de la biologie. But most of the philosophy is conveyed through their lectures, usually, and this is particularly true of these French thinkers. So Foucault was a public intellectual. He was very visible and was a very political person. He's born in 1926, the son of a surgeon, but instead of also following his father's footsteps and starting medical education, he turned towards philosophy. In university, he was particularly influenced by Jean Hyppolite, who was an existentialist, and introduced Foucault to Hegel and dialectics. And by Hippolyte's understanding of history as a process, Foucault developed his own view that philosophy must develop through the study of history. As I said before, so this is how we can read discipline and punishment. So the discipline and punish is the description how we end up in our system of discipline and control and surveillance after going through centuries of history where things have been significantly different. So between the mid-60s and the late-60s, Foucault left France to teach in Tunis. Then he taught also in Sweden, in Germany, in Poland, and according to his own description, that was in particular because he was gay and had no interest in hiding that. However, faced in France, as in most societies at that time, the impossibility to bring together his orientation and identity with being a public figure and a teacher. So I don't really know how that was not the same in Germany, for example, because I remember when homosexuality in Germany was finally legalized, so that is not that long ago, actually. However, for Foucault, it seemed to have been easier to live a life in relative freedom outside France. His own experience with psychiatry and the discrimination against people who were seen as different is what made him write his first books, which actually is the history of the clinic of hospitalization. And from there he starts and analyzes these forces in culture and society that are exerted on people. So in the time when he was writing Discipline and Punish, he was a teacher at the Collège de France at that time. That was kind of the highest of honors that a teacher could have. So in the 70s, really, he was broadly recognized. That had also to do that he was called to be the department head of the newly created philosophy department at the Experimental University Paris 8, in Vincennes-Saint-Denis. So this was a school that was by the French government institutionalized to deal with the student unrest of 1967 and 68. So politics had changed. The conservative government of the post-war era under Charles de Gaulle lost elections, and a much more progressive government under, for example, Georges Pompidou as a president got in power and tried to react on the social unrest and the dissatisfaction of the students and many people with the political situation. So Foucault stayed very critical and very political, and when the revolution in Iran finally became tangible, he went to Tehran to document the brutality in which the Shah's regime was fighting down protests, and would document the Islamist revolution that would then soon take power. And he was, I guess, the first Westerner who was given an interview by the Islamist Iranian leader Ayatollah Khomeini. Coming back, I mean, of course, in particular Americans, but also in France, he was criticized for being too close to Tehran or to Islam in general. And he replied to that openly and says, Islam and Islamism will become a major political force in this region and in the world. And the West must treat it with respect rather than hostility. So, and that is this postmodern view that you see all over his work. It doesn't mean that Foucault would never take a stand and say what's right or wrong, but it is always about respecting, listening to other people, and understanding what are their motives and cultural backgrounds. So this is, in a nutshell, what postmodernism is about. And Michel Foucault, I think, without doubt, can be called the leading mind of postmodern philosophy. So we start with now looking into what the book tells us. That is, of course, much more than I gave you to read, but feel free to maybe over the next month or maybe your lifetime to follow up on that and read all of it, because it's really worth it. So the idea of Foucault throughout his oeuvre is that power is a relationship. So it is a performance between actors. It is not necessarily just static, like for example in a hierarchy, although this is of course one expression of power, but there is always power relationships no matter how people meet. So whenever two people meet, there is some kind of power relationship noticeable between them. And in particular, power can be seen as discursive power. So in the way people speak to each other, we see that there is a power relationship. So and power, he takes these metaphors from Newtonian physics. So how do we see that power acts, that something happens, so to say? There's a force, and the force makes things change. In particular, in that respect, the force that is acting on people make people change their behavior. But Foucault says much more than their behavior. It makes them change even their minds and hearts. So, and the first form of power that he introduces right in the beginning of the book is the sovereign power. So the sovereign power is the power of, for example, a king or a supreme leader or someone whose power is just there because of their position at the top of the hierarchical pyramid. So usually, I mean, what he brings up as examples is the French king pre the French Revolution. So his example of the spectacle of torture is Louis XV, Louis XV, the Rococo king, the most splendid Rococo king that left behind a totally disastrous economy in France, so that his successor, Louis XVI, could probably no longer salvage that, and that led then in the end to the French Revolution in 1789. So we are speaking here pre-revolutionary times, but at the edge of what soon will become really the awareness of revolution in people's minds. And what he describes is the spectacle of public executions. So in a sovereign power situation, punishment of people is a public spectacle. It is performed as a theater, as Foucault says. It takes place on an open space and everyone is invited to watch. And it can be incredibly cruel and horrible. And it shows to everyone that this is the supreme power who can punish anyone who is against them in this way. And so anyone, I mean, this is the quote from the book, who dared to violate the law and by that disgraces himself or herself in front of the sovereign. So this spectacle didn't end with the French Revolution, we come to that, but I mean, in our lifetimes we have seen remnants of that. And a very interesting and quite horrible example of that is the execution of the Iraqi dictator Saddam Hussein, who was hanged on the 8th al-Adha, the December 30th in 2006. I mean, officially he was hanged by the Iraqi government, but of course that was a puppet government by the Americans who had just won the Iraqi war, and he was finally captured. So this hanging was very dramatic and in a way that is totally the spectacle. As Foucault describes it, the Iraqi government made a video of that and posted it online. So even if online video at that time was really at its infancy, I mean, YouTube was just 1 year old, that video, of course, went viral immediately. And why was that? It was not because people hated Saddam so much, which actually they did, because he was a horrible person, but because he could, from the gallows, talk to people. The last words that he said was reciting the Shahada. So he styled himself in his speech from the gallows as a hero of Islam. And so Saddam was a Sunnite, and the government that the Americans installed was, as I think the majority of people in Iraq, Shiite. So for the Sunni in Iraq, suddenly Saddam became a heroic figure, a figure of resistance against what they saw as an unjust occupation by the Americans, and of course by forces who were actually under the influence of their neighbor and longtime adversary in war, Iran. So that totally backfired. I mean, instead of showing to the world, look, this is the horrible dictator and he gets his just punishment, he is not above the law, we punish him as he deserved, which of course in the West, except in the United States, no country did does anymore. I mean, the capital punishment has been abandoned in almost every part of the civilized world, I would say. But not in the US, so the US exerts this and executes him. So, and that backfired because people said, well, he is a hero, actually. And that is the interesting thing that happened also in the 18th century in France. So the executions that should show the sovereign power of the king backfired completely by the revolutionaries giving their speeches from the gallows and breaking out in tears even, and everyone was sympathetic with them, and people would get angry and would storm the gallows and would overrun the executioner and so on. So suddenly the criminal turned to be a hero. So public executions didn't do their job anymore. And this is Foucault's theory, or Foucault's hypothesis here, is what changed political minds to transition from this brutality. But I mean, it's only a few people who were executed, actually. Most people were never punished in their life. I mean, it was not so common to be punished. It was really a spectacle in that form, to change that into a totally new form of theater, which is the surveillance theater. So the sovereign power changes to disciplinary power. And while the sovereign power uses the spectacle, disciplinary power uses surveillance. And surveillance, if we break it up, if we look at it more closely in Foucault's book, starts with a focus on the detail. That means you do no longer think of time and space as continuous, but you break it up into tiny cells and look at each compartment by itself to be closer to what happens. You atomize things. And that is also true for people, as we shall say. You don't think of people as being just people, but you say, well, there is women and men, there is people of color, there is people with, for example, disabilities, and so on. So you start compartmentalizing society and introduce means of classifying and judging each compartment, which is called examination. And with compartmentalizing and examining, you make people bending. People are no longer strong because they are on their own. And so they become docile. So they have to be soft. They have to be compliant. And you introduce a new thing that was unknown before the 19th century, which is utility. People have to fulfill a purpose. They have to make money. And then finally, the prison, with the prison architecture of the 19th century, the panopticon, is Foucault's metaphor, how surveillance works, how the power of the discipline is actually installed. So this is in the beginning of the book, I think page 6, this is a list of rules that young people in a correction facility for, basically for children, poor children who were caught begging, collected and put into this orphanage or into this kind of children's correcting home. And as you see here, every minute of the day is perfectly planned out. So the day begins at 6 a.m. and so on. And then they have to rise. That takes 5 minutes. Then prayers, all in all, not more than 30 minutes. Then work, and so on. And so this is the focus on detail. You plan out time. You cut the day in tiny parts and plan it out so that people always know where they have to be when, and everyone can control if they do that. And the same happens for adults, for thinking first in military, but then also in business processes, describing in a scientific way exactly what happens. As you see here, the description of what a step is. So the length of the short step will be a foot, the ordinary step, the double step, and the marching step will be 2 feet, and so on. And the small step takes 1 second. The double step would be performed in a little longer than 1 second, and so on. So the soldiers can't move as they want. They are introduced a regime of time. And that is what Foucault calls making their bodies docile. Docile in the sense that they do what they are told. So it is this idea of breaking up time and space, which in mathematics had been discovered about 100 years earlier, like around 1700, with the introduction of calculus by Leibniz and Newton. So the idea of calculus is that you split things in tiny steps and by that describe the change. And this same happens in the description of chemical processes with the molecules. So calculus and molecule basically mean the same thing, tiny things, tiny pebbles. And the molecule is what you describe in chemistry, and you can observe and describe precisely their reactions. And what Foucault describes is that the same happens then to people in the 19th century. So people are seen as molecules, and how people act is described in a calculus-like way. And with that comes also that you separate people out, that you install means of having them no longer interact with each other in an uncontrollable way. So this is another of the figures in the book, that is how people are supposed to write, so that you write properly. And with that comes also an interpretation that if you don't write properly, that shows some flaws in your character. So graphology is this esoteric, yeah, like pseudoscience or parascience that comes also up in the 19th century, so that you can see a people's person's character by the flaws in their handwriting. And of course, you don't want to show flaws, so you learn how to do the handwriting in a perfect way, but not like in earlier times, for the sake of being of creating aesthetic things, like a beautiful manuscript. No, just to be docile and useful. So this image is from Jacques Tati's hilariously great movie Playtime from 1967. So Jacques Tati is a satirical filmmaker in France, always playing himself as this avuncular figure in his trench coat, a bit out of place. He never speaks a word in the movies. He just walks around and encounters the weirdness of society. And this is the newly built La Défense quarter in Paris that he visits, has some appointment here, and needs to find someone to talk to in this office, and then sees how people are organized in this office in so-called cubicles. So cubicles is this separation of people into spaces that are not private. They are just kind of private, but you can look into it, you can hear what people do. You can't just always see them, but if you are like up on this gallery, you can look down and see on the desks and everything. So the cubicle becomes, starting in the 1960s, the primary way of organizing office work. And clearly not for the sake of better labor conditions. Behind that is the idea of Taylorism. So Frederick Taylor was a, yeah, you would call it probably a huckster. Around 1900, he would approach the directors of factories, in particular of steel factories, and tell them that he would have measures to make the work better. And what he did is he went on the yard and was observing how long it took for the workers to put iron rods that were just cast on a truck or on a trailer to be carried out, or on the railroad car or whatever. So, and he measured that it took them like 20 minutes to load one rod. And then he looked at the people and chose 10 of them that looked a bit more able than the others and said, if you do that in half the time, I pay you $10, which was a really large amount of money at that time, like a week's wages. And of course the people, I mean, they did that. And he said, look, you just have to incentivize people and then they do it in half the time. And so this is the invention of Taylorism, of scientific management. I mean, of course, that was a fraud. I mean, just because they can do that once, cutting the time in half, doesn't mean they can do that all day. I mean, you do that and then you are totally exhausted. So actually, Taylor was a fraudster. But still, the idea that you can manage processes in that way and that you can pay people an extra, or say, I mean, that they get paid less if they don't perform according to your performance measures, had been born at that time. And this is what Tati shows here. And if you look at, this is another scene from the movie, it's exactly how people started to live. I mean, while in times before the 19th century, most people would live in large families on the countryside as peasants, of course, in very poor conditions. And then in the 19th century, that changed. So people came to the city. At first, they would also live in large housings, totally overcrowded. But over time, a new form of living establishes in the cities, which is the apartment or the flat. So you live in your compartmentalized home with your core family, like the parents and the children. Maybe you have your old grandparents with you or not, but I mean, it's this idea of the kind of the core family that comes in the 19th century that didn't at all exist before. And this is the ideal of living. And then obviously the invention of the suburbs in the late 19th century, Chicago becoming the first city to have a tramway connecting the suburbs with the downtown city, and by that making it possible for wealthy people to buy healthy, nicely out in the green villas with a patch of land around them, this compartmentalizing and tearing people apart that used to live together and form some kind of consciousness of class and society gets much, much stronger. So, and of course, we have this kind of compartmentalization everywhere in society today. One really fascinating method of disciplinarity is examination. So, first have you seen we split things up in tiny compartments and put people in different boxes. Space and time, likewise, with the clock and the apartment, the cubicle, and so on. A second measure or second means of disciplinarity is the exam. So the exam, I mean, of course, it comes from the military. It's the entry exam of young men into the military. And that decides if you become kind of an elite soldier or sent to the desk are not accepted at all, because then, I mean, of course, you are an outsider, a disabled person. So this is the original examination. And examination spreads across society. So we have the medical examination that starts bleeding from the military into schools. So the doctor comes to the schools and examines the school children if they are all applying to the norm. Then, of course, the examination that we have to prevent illnesses. So who seems not healthy gets sent home and is excluded from society. And this idea of qualifying, judging, and punishing who is not in the norm becomes particularly strong in education. And this is really the, I would say, sad thing that I face here. This is obsession with grades, as if that would mean anything. So the grades tell you, oh, you are a B student, or a C student even, you are a loser. So it's the same, I'm kind of saying, you know, well, you are obese, or you are senile, or so. I mean, it is this making you small, and everyone swallows that and tries to strive to stay an A student. And unfortunately, I mean, you all call and I said, oh, why did I get not 100% of the points, even if your work is obviously not that great? Because the fear is in our bones. And this is the education system. We come to an education system, ideas for liberating this education system in a less oppressive way in the end of this lecture. So, examination combines hierarchical surveillance and normalizing judgment. So hierarchical surveillance is the teacher, me, looks down on you and I give you the grades. You have no chance. You submit your work and then you have to fear that it might be an A minus. However, I myself, I'm in a hierarchy too, because what you might not know, I have to submit all the grades in a nicely printed chart and then justify why I would not have a curve that would peak at B and only have a very few, like maybe one or two A's, and most of the students would have A minus to B minus, that is seen as the median. So, and it's called grade inflation that I deviate from that, and I have to justify that. So are your students really that great? So this hierarchy is the first thing. So there is a hierarchy and everyone is in this hierarchy until you are really at the top. And I mean, you really have to go far, far up. I mean, usually not even the leaders of big institutions are totally free from this kind of pressure, because they might have a ministry that oversees them. They might have shareholders, for example, looking if their revenues are still good, and so on. So this is the first part, the hierarchical surveillance. And the second part is normalizing judgment, is telling people that was not great. because I expect you to be like this. And a normalizing judgment goes really into judging the bodies. As you see in this, this is also from the book, this picture, that is not from a botanical book, where Foucault takes it. It is from a medical book. And it says, as you would do with a tree, kind of rectifying the tree and making it right, that should be the orthopedic way of making children straight. So an orthopedy means to learn how to stand upright. This is what the word originally means. And so we have all the examination all over the place. It's not only in school, of course. We have that in matrices that are imposed in work, for example, that your superior as an employee has to review your work, or as an academic teacher, you get citation indices that tell you if you are a great researcher or not, and so on. So this is everywhere in society, and according to Foucault, that's no surprise, because this is how our society installs power and keeps things together with discipline, with surveillance. And the great thing about these grades is, other than like the spectacle of beheading someone publicly, this means of disciplinarity is not only a punishment, although it can be very harsh punishment, it's also a very cheap means of reward. So it's a gratification. Oh, you are great. You get 5 stars. Well, that was not so great. It's only 3. So it has all the flexibility, and it costs nothing. You don't need expensive things to give people 5 stars. It's just, it's a click of the mouse, so to say. And this is really one of the, I think, key things that Foucault gets right here, this oppressive structure of judgment that comes with surveillance and examination. The distribution according to ranks or grade has a double role. It marks the gaps, hierarchies, qualities, skills, and aptitudes, but it also punishes and rewards. It is the penal function of setting in order and the ordinal character of judging. Discipline rewards simply by the play of awards, thus making it possible to attain higher ranks and places. It punishes by reversing this process. Rank in itself serves as a reward or punishment. Just showing you how that exists in technology. We have not talked so much about technology so far, but we'll come to that in a second. If you look at the so-called vanity matrices that are all over the social media, and here I just randomly chose some kind of advertising agencies who tell you, what are the right vanity matrices to optimize your brand performance towards, but the same in, of course, in personal performance, let's say in public relations. And then if you think of the so-called cancel culture, I just looked at the hashtag blog. So you block people. Great Twitter shows me here the UAE's Mars mission in this I need to see that. But if you look into it, it's this block is this way of telling someone that they will lose their ability to talk to you. It's kind of this this way of it's the opposite of like, so to say. It's like thumbs down. I don't want to have you. I want to block you. I want to mark your things as spam. And the fascinating thing with social media is that they had that from the beginning. There was not one social network that I would know of that was built in the time of Google and Facebook and so on that wouldn't have these vanity metrics built in, that you would always see, I have so and so many followers. You would always see how many people follow other people. You would always count your likes. And if I upload these videos to YouTube, I have to do like, I don't know how many clicks to disable the function that people can vote and like my videos. Because, I mean, why would I want to have people like my lecture videos that I only record for you? You don't need that. So this is the fascinating process of using social media to discipline and punish. So coming back to Foucault, so examination again has to do with visibility. So traditionally, power was seen, what was shown and manifested. So the king would have a palace, but that palace would not be his private home. It would be a performance, a theater stage, so to say. So like Versailles, for example, the court of the French king Louis XIV, built in the late 17th century, so about 400 years ago. So he forced all the noblemen and all the dukes and viscounts of the country to stay in his palace for at least 6 months a year. And of course, it was a very crowded place then. And why was that? Because everyone was kind of getting onto each other's nerves and so on and had to fight for better quarters. And it was all in total public. So he would perform his being a king in a performance of splendor in public. And then occasionally, of course, in these gruesome executions. So those, however, for whom the theater was played, could remain in shade. They received light only from the portion of power that was conceded to them, or from the reflection of it that for a moment they carry. So the sovereign power is, the sovereign is visible, and the subjects are basically invisible. No one cares about them. No one surveys them. And disciplinary power, on the other hand, is exercised through its invisibility. At the same time, it imposes on those who are subject compulsory visibility. The discipline, it is the subjects who have to be seen. Their visibility assures the hold of the power and that is exercised over them. It is the fact of being constantly seen, of being always to be seen, that maintains the disciplined individual in his subjection. So, and now we come to Foucault's metaphor for this. This is the panopticon. So Foucault, this is again from the book, Foucault takes this plan for a prison that in the mid-19th century was brought forward by the British engineer Jeremy Bentham. So Bentham had this idea that you can have a much better prison. I mean, the prisoners would have better conditions than in earlier, so it was seen as humane, and you could use much fewer guards to survey them if you have the prison cells kind of a circle, like really like in a theater. And in the middle is a tower from which the guards could watch everyone all the time. However, in a way that no inmate would ever know if they are watched at this moment. So this Architecture is an architecture of disciplinarity. And we should not think of it as, well, this is the panopticon, this is kind of a prison. It is a metaphor for Foucault to show how surveillance and discipline work. They work by making you aware that you might be watched, but you don't know. So you know that you are visible, but those who watch you aren't. And a while ago, I mean, like 10 years ago, the American scholar Shoshana Zuboff noticed that that happens suddenly in an unprecedented way in business. That companies, basically that starts with Google, collect vast amounts of people's personal data for whatever reason that they don't disclose. So, and this is what she calls surveillance capitalism. So, surveillance capitalism works exactly like the panopticon. You actually don't know what happens if you Google something that might be suspicious. I mean, if you live in a country like the US, I mean, you might not care that much, but there's many countries that really look that you don't do anything wrong, not naming any here. So while Google invented this to display better advertising to you, to make you more docile towards corporate messaging, the windfall of that is a gigantic surveillance machinery that is not paid for by the state or by taxpayers' money or so. It is economical. It is for the first time that you can make money off it directly. And then, of course, just harvest what's in here. So this article just came out like the other day, and so what she points out here is exactly this inequality. So I, as a subject of this surveillance, have just, I don't even know what is happening. I have no chance of fighting back, and it's totally pervasive. And it is not even that I can attack it by accountability, because it is profitable. It makes money on its own accounts. So this is really a new thing in this very Foucauldian sense. So, and what she writes, for example, is the tragedy of September 11 dramatically shifted the focus in Washington from debates over federal privacy legislation to a mania for total information awareness. This turned Silicon Valley's innovative surveillance practices into objects of intense interest. So we have actually the term that the government finally goes back to that and uses it. And that is not only in the US, of course. Many countries have installed very efficient means of tracking digital behavior. And the fascinating thing, however, is that it only works partly. So if you look after the US President Trump lost the election and then tries to stage this coup, I mean, how difficult it seems to be for the authorities to track down and arrest the people there, who clearly, I mean, totally did something illegal. So again, we see suddenly that it is probably, I mean, privileged white people don't get surveyed that much, you know, and they're not Muslims, they wouldn't, whatever Muslims do in America. So it is clearly a racist thing that's going on. It's totally classist also. Some people get surveyed, others don't, even if the technology is fully in place to survey everyone the same way. So this is a fascinating thing that you that make it totally visible what's going on. The technology is in a way, I mean, Foucault could not have dreamt of that, that we would live in a society that is so pervasively disciplinarian. So, and now the fascinating thing is how people, I mean, clearly Andy Bosworth, who is Facebook's director of augmented reality or something like that. I mean, he's, yeah. I mean, what he says here, so he hasn't read Foucault, I bet. It's a fair guess, I would say, not that I know it. And what he says here is, so, oh, yeah, we can connect people and it can be good, can make it positive, and maybe some find love, and it can be bad, and maybe they commit a terrorist attack, someone dies. However, everything that connected people more is good because it creates more money for Facebook. So it's this power of connecting people intentionally, of steering communication. And if you look into discipline and punishment, into Foucault's book, that's exactly what he describes. So the idea of panoptic surveillance is to establish presence and absence, know where and how to locate each individual, to set up useful communications or interrupt others. This is exactly what the Facebook guy says. To create this analytical space, analytical means compartmentalized, everyone is in its bucket. And we see surveillance, machinery if we look closely everywhere. I mean, on campus, it is totally, I mean, it is stunning. I mean, I think we have more than 2,000 cameras on campus. I mean, there is really no step that one can take without someone watching. And we have security guards sitting like every 5 meters. So this is a totally surveyed place. And but it can be even in a super crowded city like this is in the middle of Manhattan. You see these boxes and you realize that these antennas, that this is a mobile surveillance thing. I mean, it is an IMC tracker. It is a tracker of mobile people, of mobile devices that people carry with them, creating profiles. Knowing where people are. And this state-driven control on people's movement is basically what everyone kind of suspected that happened, but what in the documents that were leaked by Edward Snowden became totally obvious. And you have those in the readings, and I can only encourage you to look at that, because you see the methods and also the bluntness by which the security services talk about these things. I mean, there's clearly no concept of wrongdoing here on the side of the authorities. We have a commodification of this surveillance capitalism. So this is a few years back, remember the South by Southwest conference, and you would get these RFID chip wristbands and could get free drinks by that. But of course, at the same time, and you would get some kind of, yeah, what did you drink? And then it would create more suggestions, like a recommendation engine would say, well, here you are more the gin and tonic guy, and you should probably just drink water. This commodification you see in shopping malls, for example, you have to use an app to log onto the Wi-Fi. And register so that they connect a profile with who moves where. I mean, really bizarre it becomes with this kind of private surveillance thing, like your webcam doorbell camera, like the Amazon company Ring. I think I took this picture in Yas Mall. So you have this thing that Amazon comes up with that is basically you have a doorbell and a camera, but it's not you don't get the image yourself. Basically, someone at Amazon or some AI thing allegedly looks at the picture and tells if that is a proper visitor for you or if they should be sent away or maybe even the police to be called. And what Amazon not even denies is that they hand over all these videos to law enforcement. So, I mean, even if you don't want to, I mean, if you buy a thing like that, you will be surveyed by the authorities, but also by private corporations. And this cartoon is, I mean, a bit simplifying, but I mean, this is exactly what happens. So you post something, and then at the same time, this accidentally connects you to some suspicious thing. So for example, a friend of mine who is a Turkish businessman, and a very public figure suddenly noticed that some of his followers, I mean, he was notified, so to say, some of his followers were, I mean, they were Al-Qaeda people. So clearly people you don't want to be connected with. But what should he do? I mean, it was just his LinkedIn profile and he didn't pay attention. But of course, he was immediately flagged as a possible connection to terrorists. And so I know another person who ended up on the US no-flight list. And I mean, of course, no one tells you that, but I mean, they could just not book a flight anymore. And I mean, American citizen, American-born citizens. And then they found out in the end, I mean, because they were very privileged, and so they could kind of... So his wife was third-generation immigrant from Turkish ancestors in the US. So her mother's name also was like Miriam or something, a Muslim first name. And she went to Turkey to visit some relatives. And that triggered the connection, probably, I mean, somewhere in the vicinity to where she visited, there was someone who was flagged as a person of interest, POI, as that is abbreviated in intelligence language. And by that, I mean, she couldn't fly anymore. And it was so bad that these people left the US and live now in Europe. Because, I mean, in Europe, at least, you can take a train. You are not necessarily... You don't need to fly, and also there are no flight lists, I think, don't exist in that form. So this tells you that even if you think you do everything right and you pass all exams, it can still hit you just by the connections that are in the data. And we will look into that in the big data lecture. So this I found also really interesting is kind of this making surveillance a thing that gets normalized for children, even in this Mickey Mouse cartoon magazine, where you have this gimmick of a fake surveillance camera. And then, of course, we have the other side, and the propaganda on that is also, I mean, really stunning. So we have dark data. So that's kind of the other side of surveillance is the organized crime people and the terrorists or so, they have that also. So they are also, I mean, these hackers, they understand. They understand how it works. And this is why we have to outsmart them with cyber intelligence. So this is discipline. The discipline is installed by surveillance. We have sovereign power with the spectacle. We have discipline with surveillance. And the last part is biopower that uses force over your biological existence. So this device is a pocket-sized DNA sequencer. So why would you need a thing like that? I mean, basically to identify people. The idea of an identity that is quantifiable is part of the surveillance power thing. So you get an ID card that tells you, that tells everyone basically when you were born, I mean, whatever that matters. It gives you an ID number, it might be connected to your phone, and so on. So the idea of an identity of your individual makes you one and makes you disconnected from other people. And you get even deeper into the physical existence if you look into your genome as part of your identity. And there is an obsession with that. If you look at ancestorial services like 23andMe or Ancestors.com, Ancestry.com, that people construct their identity of these genetic relations, that I say, well, I'm 25% Italian, whatever that means. I mean, of course, I'm not. I mean, what does that mean? Is that why I eat pasta? So, I mean, but this is exactly what you see. I mean, this person is a proper Emirati. This person is a proper Maghrebi. This person is a proper West African, or whatever granularity you introduce into the data. And the discussion, for example, of being indigenous is often tied now to the ability to prove that you really are by genetics. And behind that is the idea that your genome defines who you are. It predetermines you. This is the creed of the of biopower. So there is no escape. It's like being fixed. And this, of course, then justifies of being put into a certain class or caste or whatever box you find. So this is, I think, what we face now, kind of coming up, and it is not so much about surveillance here. I mean, to make that clear, it's not about discipline, because you can't do anything about it. It is the power about your body, and the idea behind that that you cannot escape. You have to face it. I mean, it is age, it is race and gender, it's disabilities or ableness, and that finally decides who's in and who's out. And of course, this is the final mechanism behind the genocide as its extreme form. This is working not with means of saying, well, this person has articulated revolutionary ideas, this is why we have to put them in prison. No, this person has been identified as someone of Uyghur ancestry, and this is why he gets sent into a concentration camp. So we don't need to go back in history to find that still present in our world. So I don't want to leave this lecture without encouraging a bit and having a bit of optimism here, in so that there is actually a way out. I mean, of course, not every country is a total dictatorship. So in most countries there is always kind of a things are more fluid, and there is indeed resistance going on. Techno resistance here. I think that kind of conversation that or kind of argument that Mozilla has with the government in Kazakhstan is meaningful. I mean, they have a lot of audience. I mean, if Mozilla Foundation says something, people listen, and of course the government might then consider to do things differently. I don't want to judge what happened here. I don't know much about the conflict that they address. I just found this news item in a way encouraging, because you see that that there is resistance happening. And thinking of one of the most beautiful books that I know about doing things differently and resisting disciplinarian power in particular is Paulo Freire's Pedagogy of the Oppressed. So Paulo Freire, Brazilian critical philosopher and thinker about education, and in 1968 wrote this book And what he writes is very encouraging. I mean, he writes about that we have an unconscious fear of freedom, that we are afraid of changing the world, and kind of there is not so much intention in oppression. Usually, it just is a result more than intended ends of what people fear. But in a way, I mean, everyone in a oppressive system is dehumanized. So we should think of everyone like the children, the teacher, the students, the teacher. Everyone in a system like that is unfree. And so revolutionary education is to end that, is to end this system of giving grades. It's a system having a curriculum and forcing people to learn what is defined as knowledge. And by that, I mean, finally, I mean, it's exactly what Michel Foucault over his lifetime argued always, that defining what is knowledge, what is truth, is the original form of power. In the studio, we will look into other forms of resistance that we can technologically deploy, namely using cryptographic tools to secure our communication, or maybe at least blur a bit what we do, and by that trying to escape surveillance capitalism.